The topic of my talk is choice of law agreements upon property, regime, divorce, and succession. And I'm going to divide my talk into five parts, as you can read in this slide. Let's start by telling that the idea of giving the parties a role in the definition of their personal and family relations has now a great relevance in the private international law of the European Union. The same approach is followed in the recent EU regulations, and if you look at these slides, you can quickly see what parties can choose according to Article 5 for divorce, Article 5 of Rome 3, or what they can choose for matrimonial property, Article 22 of the Matrimonial Property Regulation, or for property consequences of registered partnership, Article 22 again of the Registered Partnership Regulation, and finally, for succession, Article 22 again, but it's a chance, I mean, it's always the same number, I think, but anyway, for succession, Article 22 of the Succession Regulation. You already know this provision, I think, and so we can quickly move on to the next point of my presentation. And the next point of my presentation is why. Why such a large use of party autonomy in the European regulations? And the reason of the party. What do the party's reasons depend on? Firstly, generally speaking, as you can read in the preamble of all of these regulations, freedom of choice provides a certain, predictable, and for property regime, also permanent regulation of the relationship. Party autonomy is indeed the best way to preserve the party's interest, since such autonomy is based on the assessment by the parties of the advantages and disadvantages of the substantive rules. In practical terms, it means for divorce the choice of the law that allows a more rapid and inexpensive divorce. For succession, it's a way to organize the succession in advance by choosing the law applicable to the succession as a whole, as clarified in recital 38 of the succession regulation. And moreover, it is self-evident that giving the testator the power to choose the applicable law means giving the testator the power to avoid forced heirship provisions. But I'd like to expand a little bit on this point later. But party may also have cultural reasons and choose their own national law. And don't forget that the application of the national law makes the recognition and enforcement of the judgment in the state of origin easier. Secondly, party autonomy may be very useful for overcoming the difficulty in determining the habitual residence. Janine yesterday explained the difficulties and problems in determining the habitual residence of the children. Let me just add that we don't have yet a definition of the Court of Justice regarding adults, regarding divorce. The Court of Justice actually developed a definition of habitual residence regarding adults in other fields of law, but pointed out also that its previous case law cannot be exported to family law context. And the same does the succession regulation. The succession regulation that addressed the issue of the definition of habitual residence in recital number 23 and 24 pointed out that no interinstrumental interpretation is intended. Let's move now on to the last, at least in my presentation, but in this context, maybe the most important reason of a choice: the need for coordination. The need for coordination among the EU regulations. In practice, spouses litigate over the financial consequences of divorce. As such, it is advisable to allow the same law to govern all these issues. Another reason is the wish to select a single law for matrimonial property or property consequences of registered partnerships and succession. As Maria just said in her presentation, there is a strong interaction, in every legal system between matrimonial property, property consequences of registered partnership and succession laws, and this interaction justifies the need that the same law govern both of them. The liquidation of the property regime is very, very often a question preceding the liquidation of the estate of the deceased. And in almost all legal systems, the extent of the participation of the surviving partner or spouse is affected by the marriage partnership regime's rule. Well, now the question is, and the question is very simple. Does it work? I mean, can the possibility of making a choice provided in all these regulations achieve these goals? And how can they be combined? How can the agreement on the property regime be combined with the agreement for divorce provided in Rome III, or with the choice of law provided in succession, when there is a need to combine the applicable law? Because, as I said, in practice, there is a need. These matters are often addressed in the same proceedings. And in order to answer to this question, that is the main question of my presentation, as Janine said, I think that this slide could be useful. As you know, all these regulations allow a limited choice of law. You have here in a glance all the connections which can be chosen in a choice of law agreement upon property regimes, divorce, and succession. Without a choice of law, the goal of coordination among all these regulations could also be achieved, but it is not so easy. It is true that in the different regulations, the same connecting factor, in particular habitual residence and nationality, have been generally used, but it is also true that the moment they are referred to is often different, as you can see in this slide, regarding the law applicable in absence of choice. For example, Article 26 of the MP regulation, matrimonial property regulation, refers to the common habitual residence as first connecting factor in a cascade of the connecting factors at the time of marriage. While Article 8 of Rome III refers to the moment common habitual residence, but at the moment at which the court is seized for divorce proceedings. The moment is different. And the MP regulation, matrimonial property regulation, does not contain a specific provision to apply the same law as to divorce and legal separation, as on the contrary, it provides for the determination of jurisdiction. The new regulations are indeed very interesting, because they seek to achieve a coordination with the previous regulations. The need for coordination is clearly a key concern of the European legislature. And it was for jurisdiction. But for applicable law, without an agreement, a dissociation between the applicable laws may frequently happen. Here we are. Let's start with the first examples. Lenka, a Czech woman, and Jens, a German man, marry and live in Hamburg. After a number of years, they move to Madrid. The spouses live there for several years before applying to the Spanish courts for divorce. They have not made an agreement on the law to be applied to the divorce or matrimonial property regime. The question is, which law or laws will be applicable? You can answer if you wish. I mean, it's not just a rhetoric question. But anyway, which law? First problem, jurisdiction, of course. Jurisdiction, is in this case a concentration of the jurisdiction possible? The answer is yes. It's possible because in this case we can concentrate the proceeding in one single competent court, Spanish court, pursuant to Article 3 of Basel IIa and, as Maria said, Article 5 of Matrimonial Property Regulation. What about the applicable law? Without an agreement, the result would be a lack of coordination, German law for matrimonial property and Spanish law for divorce. Oops, sorry. Yeah. And which law could they choose when they agree on the applicable law? Both German or Spanish law. And both for the same law for divorce and property. It depends, obviously. It depends on the moment of the choice. Another example, same couple, Lenka Jens, Czech, German, but doesn't matter, marry and live in Hamburg, they move to Madrid, and then, unfortunately, Jens decides to leave Lenka and moves to France, where he finds a job. After 1 year, he files for divorce in France. Again, which law will be applicable in this case? Jurisdiction? Same question. In this case, could we have one single court competent for both? And the answer is yes and no. Because jurisdiction of the French court, yes, is based on Article 3.1, fifth indent of Brussels 2A, because it's a court in which the applicant, Jens, is habitual residence for at least 1 year immediately before the application, but a choice of court agreement is needed according to Article 5.1A of the Matrimonial Property Regulation. Which law could they choose? We have four laws at stake in this case, German, Czech, Spanish, French. Yes, they could choose all of them. It depends on the moment of the agreement, again. Without an agreement, the result is French law for divorce and German law for matrimonial property. So we have a lack of coordination. Now, let's turn to the need for coordination, not between property and divorce, but between property and succession. Eric and Margareta, Swedish, are married and live in Belgium. After some years, they move back to Sweden, where, unfortunately, Eric dies. Which law will be applicable in this case? First problem, as usual, jurisdiction. Jurisdiction, yes, it's possible to test exactly the objective of the new regulation. It's possible to concentrate all disputes in the same court, yes. Article 4 of the Matrimonial Property Regulation aligns the member state jurisdiction which deals with matrimonial property regime in the event of the death of one of the spouses with that ceased for proceeding under the succession regulation. And it's the same for the registered partnership regulation, but as we have already heard, the court of a member state whose law does not provide for registered partnership may decline jurisdiction, Article 9 of the registered partnership regulation. Well, applicable law. Without a choice, in absence of choice, what we have? What we have is, let me go back to this slide. Last habitual residence of the decuius for successions versus first common habitual residence for property. In this case, two different laws. In this case, two different laws, Belgian law for matrimonial property and Swedish law for succession. Because the two regulations diverge with regard to the time at which the applicable law is frozen. A coordination is possible if the party chooses, of course, the Swedish law. The Swedish law, and this case, there is also coincidence between forum and ius, because the Swedish court, as the court of the last habitual residence of the decuius, has a jurisdiction according to Article 4 of the succession regulation. Well, as I already mentioned, the coordination between the new regulations and the succession regulation is a key concern of the European legislator. However, a dissociation between the two laws, the law applicable to property regime and the law applicable to succession, cannot be avoided in case of the partners or spouses have different nationality. The choice of the law of which one of them is national, and that is the only possibility open to them according to the succession regulation, leads to the application of two different laws. Here's the case. Jens German and Francois French are registered partners living in Hamburg. I love Hamburg, so that's why. In their life partnership agreement, they agree on the application of the German law to their property regime. Then they move to France and live there for several years. They would like to ensure that German law also applies to their succession. Because in the French law does not provide for inheritance rights for partners. Jens may choose the German law because it's the law of his nationality, but Francois may not, according to Article 22 of the Section Regulation. The only way to ensure that the same law continues to apply to both proceedings would be to make a new property regime agreement indicating the law of their new common habitual residence, the French law. But they do not want the application of the French law. No way. The partners may, however, provide for each other through an agreement as to succession according to the German law, because it's provided in Article 25(3) of the regulation. But it's not the applicable law to the succession as a whole. Well, we have just seen that there is the possibility to combine the choice of law agreements with regard to the connections that may be chosen, but in order to the formation of a comprehensive agreement covering both areas, it's not enough. What else is important? What else is essential to the formation of a comprehensive agreement covering both areas? Consistency between the formal requirements of the agreement. And also the moment of the agreement is important. Formal requirements. Article 7 of Rome 3 and Article 23 for choice flow agreement, Article 25 for matrimonial property agreement. Of the MP regulation, as you can read in this slide, follows the same structure. The written form is enough. The notarial act is required only if it's required by one of the legal systems indicated in this slide. Let's take the example of Germany and Italy. In Germany, the notarial act is required by the law. In Italy, no. As in France, I'm not sure, but I know that there is some French lawyer here. In France, I think that the written form is enough as well as in Italy. I quoted here this judgment because it's interesting. because the Tribunale di Pordenone, Pordenone is a small town in the Italian nowhere. I hope that nobody of you come from Pordenone, but it's really a small town, but with a lot of very, very interesting cases. Maybe in Pordenone they are full of cross-border family, I don't know. But they have a lot of cases coming from Pordenone. I've never been in Pordenone, but anyway. So that's an interesting judgment given by Tribunale of Pordenone regarding a divorce between an Italian wife and U.S. husband. In this proceeding, the court accepted that the choice of law in favor of the U.S. law, not of the Italian law, was expressed by the husband per email. He sent an email. It was difficult to find the husband. I guess that it was also the reason for the divorce. I mean, if you have an husband riding his motorbike all around Europe and you cannot find him, even for the proceeding of divorce, I mean, that's a good ground for divorce. But anyway, it was a divorce per email. Because it's allowed in Rome 3, Article 7.1, state that any communication by electronic means which provides a durable record of the agreement shall be deemed as valid. Succession now. Succession, formal requirement concerning the formal requirement, which you can read in Article 22 of the regulation. I'd just like to draw your attention on the issue of the tacit choice. The example could be the creation of a testamentary trust by a British national living in Italy, for example, or the establishment of a joint will by German nationals living in a country in Italy where joint wills are not allowed. That is a tacit choice. But as you read in this slide, such a choice may be demonstrated by the terms of the disposition of property upon death, but not by the circumstances of the case. It's not like in Rome 1 for the commercial matters. I mean, language is not important. In order to the formation of a comprehensive agreement, formal requirement, consistency between formal requirements is important, but also the moment of the agreement. And the moment of the agreement, we have already discussed it, about prenups. Prenups, that's my opinion. Are the parties allowed to enter into an agreement even before the marriage? Prenups. In my opinion, no doubt that the MP regulation will be applied to prenups. Recital 45 clarifies that the choice may be made at any moment before the marriage, at the time of the conclusion of the marriage, or during the marriage. On the contrary, prenups seem to be excluded from the Rome III regulation, as Article 5 of Rome III refers only to the spouses. Moreover, Article 5 indicates the current or the last common habitual residence within the option contemplated. However, in my opinion, this interpretation is correct, of course, from a literal point of view, but raises some doubts from a concrete standpoint. It seems reasonable that the parties can agree on the applicable law on the divorce in a prenups. Assuming that the choice of law regarding the divorce is not valid, it would affect the aim of submitting divorce and its financial consequences to a single law by a single act. Up to what time may the agreement be concluded? You already know that Rome 3, the spouses for Rome 3, the spouses can choose the law applicable during the course of the proceeding. And I give you in this slide some references, but I think that we can move on to the next point of my presentation, because I'd like to conclude my presentation, not yet, I mean 10 minutes, I have still 10 minutes so far. I'd like to mention some issues arising in the case law. the case law regarding choice of course agreements. As Janine said, I'm the coordinator of a project co-funded by the European Commission with this title, Planning the Future of Cross-Border Families, a Power Through Coordination. And our project aims at identifying the difficulties met by courts and practitioners in applying these regulations. We are preparing a database, which will be soon, I hope, made public, freely available at this site, collecting and classifying national case law in English. And I've tried to identify the main issues and practical difficulties arising from this case law with regard to choice of law agreement. Almost all the judgments collected regard, that's obvious, Article 5 of Rome 3. And, well, you already know what parties can choose according to Article 5 of Rome 3, but what do parties actually choose? It has to be borne in mind that these regulations have a universal character, and as I already said, in most cases, the parties choose a law that allows a more rapid and inexpensive divorce, and quite often there are also cultural reasons. And it happens in some cases regarding Moroccan couples or Moroccan, Italian, or Spanish couples living in Italy or in Spain, in which the chosen law is Moroccan, as I quoted in this slide. And I also like to draw your attention on a very interesting decision of the Oberlandesgericht Am. The spouses, an Iranian-German wife and an Iranian husband living in Germany, had concluded a marriage contract, which, according to the Iranian law, allowed the wife to exercise the option of delegated repudiation. In this contract, they didn't choose explicitly the Iranian law. But this contract, marriage contract, was deemed as valid, as a valid choice in favor of Iranian law because it included some notions of Iranian code. And the wife, in front of the judge and the husband's lawyers, the husband's lawyer, uttered the talak formula according to the procedure provided in the marriage certificate and allowed by the Iranian law. And it's interesting to note that in this case, the law chosen regulated not only the substance of the divorce, but also some procedural aspect, because the wife pronounced the phrase according to the Iranian law. And it's also interesting to note that probably this divorce, this repudiation, in Iran, according to the Iranian law, would not be deemed valid, because the Iranian law requires that the two witnesses are male and Muslims. And we don't know if the German judge and the lawyer were Muslims. But I know, because I asked for an opinion to a colleague of mine that is an expert in Islamic law, and she was really surprised for this reason. But let's move on. As I said, as it's possible to apply the law of any state, two main problems seem to arise in the case law, public policy, and proof of the foreign law. Public policy, you know what public policy is. I just give you two references because, as you know, for public policy, a case-by-case analysis is required, and the answer of the court, that's my point, may not always be the same. Audiencia Provincial Logroño, sorry for the pronunciation. According to the Spanish judge, the Moroccan Civil Code of 2004 is contrary to the public policy. Same facts, same law, different judge. Tribunale Firenze. Perfect pronunciation, thank you. The Italian judge stated that the Moroccan family code, the same law, is not contrary to public policy. And now let's turn to another case of public policy of the French Code de Cassation. You are French, aren't you? and it regards epranaps. Epranaptial agreement concerning the economic consequences of divorce, governed by German law, chosen by the parties as a national law of the husband, which excluded any compensatory allowance. The couple divorced in France and the wife requested a compensatory allowance, and the first and second instance courts rejected the request according to the marriage contract. The French Cour de Cassation overruled the Court of Appeal decision on the ground that according to Article 13 of the Hague Maintenance Protocol, the judge should have checked whether the effect of German law, the exclusion of the allowance, were contrary to French international public policy. Well, very quickly, proof of foreign law. You know, it could be a problematic issue. In particular, in those states where it's, the foreign law is deemed, is considered having a factual nature. Here I give you a decision of the Oberlandesgericht Nuremberg that you probably know. German Kazakh couple with, human, with habitual residence in Germany. They asked for legal aid in order to file for divorce. The court of first instance refused the legal aid as a German law applicable according to Article 8 of the regulation requires a period of separation. The parties live together. And the party argued that they intended to choose a Kazakh law which provides for divorce without a period of separation. Nevertheless, the court of first instance did not grant legal aid as the parties should have agreed on the applicable law before filing for legal aid. Correctly, in my opinion, the court of second instance, the Oberlandesgericht, overruled the decision of the first instance court, stating that Article 46 de EGBGB provides for the choice of law during the proceedings, according to Article 5 of Rome 3. However, and that's a point regarding the proof of foreign law, however, no official translation of the Kazakh law was possible, was provided during the proceedings, and instead a Russian speaker lawyer was able not to provide the translation, but confirmed what the parties said. And even though the statement of this lawyer could not be fully reliable because it was not a translation, the court stated that it was enough to grant legal aid. That's it. Let me conclude my presentation with another issue concerning subsection, not encountered in the case law yet, but I think that it's interesting and it could be. As I mentioned at the beginning of my presentation, the power to choose the applicable law entails the risk of a choice concluded with the only purpose to avoid forced heirship provisions. Mr. Rich is an American widower born in New York who retired 15 years ago and decided to spend his retirement age in Côte d'Azur with his new young French girlfriend. Mr. Rich owns a wonderful villa in France and millions of, a lot of money. He has two adult children from his previous marriage who blame him for his new menage. Is very upset with them, so intends to bequeath all his possession to his girlfriends. It happens in the real life. He adds to his last will a choice of law clause in favor of New York law. Mr. Rich wants to take advantage of the party autonomy as a connecting factor. That's clear. But the question is it possible under the new succession regulation? And I'm afraid that the answer is yes. In the succession regulation, there are no special protective rules for family members because the choice limited to the national law, that's the only possibility open to the curious or to the individual, some, to the parties in the regulation, was deemed to be enough to avoid such a risk. So there are no special protective rules for family members. One may wonder if there are other possible mechanisms to avoid the risk of abuse of rights or fraud. Public policy? Public policy? I'm afraid not. But anyway, public policy, the application of public policy must be restrictive according to the case law of the Court of Justice and also to recital 58 of the regulation. I recall here some judgment of the Supreme Court, which proved to be quite controversial regarding the recourse of public policy in these cases. For example, the Italian Court of Cassazione in 2006 stated that the Canadian law applicable in that case as the deceased was Canadian was not contrary to the public policy, even if it does not provide for the forced heirship. In the same line of reasoning, there are the judgments of the Tribunal Federal Suisse, here, and Tribunal Supreme Espagnol. On the contrary, the Bundesverfassungsgericht, as you probably know, stated that the right of the children to be entitled to a reserved portion is guaranteed by the Constitution. But actually, I do not know how useful this case law could be considered, as these judgments have been pronounced with regard to the national conflict of law rules. Once a succession regulation is in force, one must keep the objectives of the regulation in mind, and in particular, the objective of ensuring the application of a single law to the whole succession and the favor for the freedom of individuals. Fraud à la loi. The fraud à la loi is considered in the succession regulation in recital 2026, but in the succession regulation, an effective link with the law chosen is not required. And if no text of effectivity is required, I cannot see how you can prove the fraudulent intent. In conclusion, I think that party autonomy could be very useful for many reasons, as I tried to demonstrate in my presentation. But I think also that there is a need to protect the weaker party, often the less wealthy party. And real protection is possible only in a system that ensures free choice, where neither of the parties is coerced into the choice. And such protection can only be reached by assuring the provision of adequate information by professionals, including lawyers, notaries, and judges. I finish here, and I thank you very much for your attention. And if you have any questions, I will be happy to answer them. Thank you.